storm surrounding me, let it cry at your name. Still call the sheet, still the rage in me, still every wave at your name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, the silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe, call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I was just testing your quality of patience. I was testing patience to see if the fruit of the spirit of patience that you've learned it. Eh? So see, Cecil, you're growing in patience, right? No, praise the Lord. I just messed up. Forget that. I need to tell the truth because all liars go to the lake of fire, right? All right, praise the Lord. We're going to have a great time. Stand up this morning. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Day we've gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. 'Cause you're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, feeling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now, Lord, unveil us. 'Cause you're the reason,
you're the reason we're here.
'Cause you're the reason,
you're the reason we're singing.
Yeah, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, feeling every part of our praise. Yeah, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, feeling every part of our praise.
Show us, 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 show us,
this morning.
You deserve it.
my hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
He deserves all the praise and glory and honor. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is the time when true worshipers will worship Him. And these are the days when my Father's ways will be known to man. This is the hour when the Spirit's power will move again. Oh, as we worship Him in spirit and in truth, we cry, holy and holy, holy, holy is Your name.
You are
worthy,
so worthy, Lord.
Worthy, let all the earth proclaim
Your mighty and
mighty,
so mighty, Lord.
Mighty,
there is no God like You, and we worship You in spirit and in truth. We cry, holy and
holy,
holy,
holy, holy is Your name.
You are
worthy,
so worthy, Lord.
Worthy,
oh, let
all the earth proclaim
Your mighty and
mighty,
so mighty, Lord.
Mighty,
oh,
there is no God like You,
and we worship You in spirit. One more time. Oh, we cry, holy and
holy,
so
holy, holy, holy is Your name.
You are
worthy,
so worthy, Lord.
Worthy,
oh,
let all the earth
truth. Yes, we worship you in spirit and in truth. Let's just worship Jesus. Praise and honor, glory, Lord. Hallelujah.
We worship you, Lord.
Oh, yeah. Everybody sing and we cry, holy,
holy.
Worshiping this morning. After all, tithes and offerings, giving is an act of worship, right? We bring of our substance to Him this morning. And I just want to say thank you all for giving today. Yes, you're giving to the local church so that we can continue to do the things we do. But most of all, you're giving unto God. Amen? Because He says to give and it shall be given back to you. Now, we don't give, as I've always said, our first priority is not to give to get. We're giving because we love God if nothing was in return. But here's the great thing about God. He asks us to give 10%. Of our earnings, and He blesses us back with even more. Amen? Because His word says so, right? So He doesn't have to do that, but He loves us, and He gives back to us through our obedience. So this morning, let's have the mentality, not as like the Bible says, we don't give with an obligation or where it's a have to, but let's give because we want to, because we do it because God wants us to. We love Him first of all. God loves the local church. He wants us to give to that, to where you come each and every week also, in return, out of his love and goodness, he's going to bless us above and beyond what we would know. Sometimes it comes immediate. Many times it comes later. But the Bible says that he will bless you, pressed down, shaking together, and running over, if you give. So I trust the Lord. Don't you trust the Lord this morning? And if we trust him, he'll always provide for us. Amen. Lord, we just thank you for the people giving this morning. We just thank you for, Lord, we thank you, most of all, for you. We just love you and we worship you this morning with this gift we bring. Lord, and it's because we love God and because we imitate you, we also love people. We're not asking to take something from anybody because it goes to the church. But what we are asking is people to give liberally, give with a heart of love, and cheerfully, because you and your goodness are going to bless them back. So in actuality, what we're doing is, it's just a good thing for all. It funds the local church. It lets us keep going and do the things we need to promote the gospel and to teach people and love people every week. And also, it's going to in turn give you a blessing for doing that out of your act of obedience. So it's just a great thing overall. So Lord, we just know that. We believe that this morning. Bless those that give, and in due season, return to them even more than they could even expect. We ask it all in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everybody says, amen.
This is the time when true worshipers will worship him. And these are the days when my Father's ways will be known to man. This is the hour when the Spirit's power will move again. And oh, as we worship him in spirit and in truth, we cry, in spirit and in truth. Yes, we worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. The Lord is good, isn't he? Are you glad to be here this morning? Praise the Lord. I am too. Praise God. God is a wonderful, good God, and he loves us all. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So, today I want to talk about, the title of my message is going to be Consistency Always Wins. I've been playing tennis recreationally for many, many years. I coached for 2 years at Nass Central High School. I enjoy the game, my sons play, and we've had a lot of fun this summer. With all this stuff going on, you can't do a lot of different things, but you can get outside and have some fun and recreation. So we've been doing a lot of that. And what I've learned about the game of tennis is that consistency wins. I mean, in a lot of sports it is, but particularly this sport. Because a lot of people, I've always heard, they say, well, you know, I could have beaten that guy, but all he was is a pusher. He just pushes everything. He's just a pusher. So I looked it up, I've always heard that. So I looked it up in Wikipedia, and it told me what a pusher was. A pusher in tennis is a defensive player who pushes back any shot they can chase down without deliberately hitting a winner. They can angle shots, aim deep, as well as produce effective lobs. They're extremely quick and consistent, rarely making errors. And I remember one time I was reading this article, and it was a college tennis player, and he was making excuses about he couldn't hardly win because all these pushers kept beating him. But his coach reached out and talked to him and said, son, said, here's the deal. The point of the whole game, the most important thing from fundamentally we're speaking, is you've got to hit the ball over the net to the other side and into court. So if they're pushing you and they're beating you and you're losing, then I wouldn't blame it. I'd still keep doing the same thing. And what is it that pushers do? They're not great. They don't go for big shots. But what do? They're consistent. They don't make mistakes. They're just waiting for you to make a mistake. And see, so in life, in order to be consistent in your emotions and in the way you do things, you have to think the right thoughts, especially during trials and tribulations. And you have to be consistent, right? It's okay to get high and to love things and just accept and just, you know, celebrate and go crazy over something and get real excited, as long as when you come off that high, you still maintain stability and consistency. Look, has anybody here today had something to happen to you this week, not necessarily catastrophic, but that you didn't like or was not favorable to you? You don't have to tell what it is, just if you have. Something simple, right? Most all of us, if we be truthful, have that at least once in a while. But you see, if something happens to you in a negative way, you and I need to decide not to get into a bad mood or to let our emotions rule us. You and I can decide not to get in a bad mood. Am I right about that? Say with me today, I can decide to not get in a bad mood. You have the power to do that. After all, did not the Apostle Paul say, in the Bible, he said, you put away malice. You put away strife. You put away envy. You. In other words, we have a part to play in it. See, when we have wrong thoughts, it can lead to wrong emotions. Then we start saying the wrong things. Then our mood can go sour, and that's when we can really get nasty if you want to get right down to it. See, remember, there's power in your words. When you feel yourself sinking and getting in a bad mood because of your circumstances or because of what somebody said to you, say out loud to yourself, I will not get in a bad mood. Amen. You don't have to live by your feelings. You can live on the other side of them. But the bottom line is in life, you're going to always have to press through your feelings to be consistent. To be consistent in everything, in your thinking, in your actions, and whatever you do, you're going to have to press through your feelings. How often, let me ask you a question. How often will we have to cast down bad thoughts? Every day. If not every day, every hour, every minute almost, right? Because the adversary, the devil, is trying to put thoughts in our mind. You see, when Jesus defeated Satan at the cross, he defeated him. He has no power at all. Everybody gives way too much credit to the devil. He has no power. But here's what he has. He's smart in an evil way. He has the ability, because he's still the author of this world, because Adam gave him that authority, he still gives thoughts, ideas, and suggestions to you and I that are not right. So, you say, how will I know if that's wrong? Well, if it doesn't line up with what this says, guess who is giving you a wrong thought? Guess who's giving you a wrong idea? Guess who's giving you a wrong suggestion? You have to take captive of that thought. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. I like what the NLT says this. It says, we destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. Have you ever thought about that Jesus is referred to as the rock of our salvation? Amen? I'm going to the rock. You ever heard the song? I'm going to the rock of my salvation. Right, he is the rock. I'm sorry to tell you people, if you don't know, in this secular world, Dwayne Johnson is not the rock. Jesus is the rock, okay? Because Dwayne Johnson, I'm sure at times changes. I'm sure he's not perfect. In fact, I know he's not perfect, like all of us. But Jesus is the rock. He is solid. He is stable in every way, at all times, everywhere. And he never changes. Isn't that good? That you serve a God that never changes. He exemplifies stability and consistency in everything he does and says. In fact, the Bible says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We are striving to be that way, but we can never be that way because he is perfect in every way. That's why he was our substitute on the cross. That's why he was born of a virgin birth. He was not born of corruptible seed, but was born of the Holy Spirit, incorruptible seed. Yet he came onto earth, the Word became flesh, and yet he was 100% God, yet 100% man, and never failed. Thank God for Jesus today. He is solid. You're talking about consistent, 100%, never changes. You don't have to worry about when you go to him what mood he's going to be in tomorrow. You don't have to worry about when you talk with him what he's thinking of you. Even though you make mistakes, he says, come unto me, all ye who are labor and heavy laden. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. We are supposed to imitate him, right? Right? So if we are supposed to imitate him, then we need to be what? Consistent as we can be. God needs to be able to depend on you and I. And if you're all over the place and you're this day one, you're this way one day and this way the next, can he depend on you? People need to depend on you and I. But if you're one way the next day, one way the other, can people depend on you? Actually, if we want self-esteem and self-esteem, which everybody's looking for today, and respect, we need to be able to depend on us. I know that's not right English, but ourselves. In other words, we got to depend on ourselves. You can't depend on yourself. Nobody else can depend on you, and God surely can't, if you can't even depend on yourself. Right? It's not a good way to live. It's not good to have not have control of your emotions, and it's going to be reflected in your relationships. See, not letting feelings rule you, though, gets easier. It's hard at first. That's why our spirit man, when we're born again, is perfect unto God, but that's why the Bible says to renew your minds, right? Because you just don't automatically get it all and you're just perfect instantly. If we weren't striving to always be perfect and to get where we need to be and more consistent, if we already had it all together and knew everything and were perfect and consistent every day, every minute, there'd be no need for us to come today. But we come to be reminded of what we need. Amen? Not in a condemning way. Jesus says there's no condemnation to those in Christ. So whenever I speak to you, I don't speak to you in a condemning way. I do it in a teachable way that we all are reminded of what Christ wants us to do and how to live. And I believe that he wants us to be consistent and stable in our thinking and in our emotions. Jesus, when he was in the temple and they were buying and selling goods and he turned over the tables, I imagine Jesus himself, before he did that, took time to think about what he was going to do. You see, because he is a thoughtful man. Yes, he did not like it, but that was a righteous anger that came up in him, but it wasn't of the flesh. Amen? He still took time to think about it, and then he made his action. Even sometimes when we do something that's a little bit considered tough, we still need to think through it before we do it and make sure that God is directing us in the way to do it. Amen? Even when we discipline our children, or if you're a boss, when you talk to the employees, be kind and respectable, yet at the same time, if you need to be direct, do it with the heart of love. Don't just jump into it and let your emotions take control. I remember back in the days in the late 90s, everybody in the stock market before it crashed was doing all this day trading. They'd buy something, sell it next day, buy something, sell it within an hour. And there was a funny commercial one time where this guy, he bought all of this stock and it went up. I mean, within 30 minutes, it went up astronomically. And he got excited and he got all gleeful. But the problem was he didn't sell it and take the profit. He got so, he said, this thing is going to keep rolling. And he's on the first floor. He goes up to the second floor where his boss is, and he just lays his boss out and tells him, this is the sorriest job I've ever, I'm so glad I'm making so much money in the market, I don't need you no more, ha, 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 and left him. When he got back down to his computer, he was actually losing money. Would you say that he let his emotions mess him up? Right? He was a little bit too gleeful. So then he had to go sheepishly, the commercial showed, back to his boss. Sorry, please forgive me. I didn't mean anything. I don't know what overcame me. See, a lot of times you don't know what overcame you. You say, why did I do that? Because we haven't learned to be consistent in our thought life, consistent in our emotions. What, everything you say or do or how you act is a reflection of you, a reflection of how you handle things, and it can either help you or cost you something. Don't lose something valuable because you are not consistent in how you deal with things. See, but at the same time, don't get under guilt. It gets easier the more you learn how to be consistent in what God says and how to act in life. Just like exercising at first has a lot of pain to it. If you've never lifted weights, or even if you do, when I was in high school, I was very, very consistent, very committed to lifting weights. Since then, not so. So ever so often, if I get around, if I go somewhere or somebody has some weights, and then I'll be doing it, and I'll do too much, and then the next day I'm like, oh, good gosh, I can tell I did too much. Did too much weight or too many repetitions. See, it's because I've not been doing it. But if I keep on doing it, my body would get used to it. I would get strong, right? That's the way we are with obeying the Word of God and being consistent in our actions, in our thoughts, and in our emotions. The more we practice it, even if we fail, don't get down, get back up, and do it again. Don't quit even if you fail, even if you say something inappropriate, or you do something inappropriate off a whim, or you lose your temper and you regret what you did. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. Thank you for your grace. Thank you that I didn't mess up or something bad didn't happen. Please help me the next time to be consistent in my lifestyle. And the Bible says that we know one another. That we know we are His disciples because we love one another. See, let's be consistent, love one another, be careful in how we do and what we say. You can discipline yourself to rule over your feelings. See, if we are ruled by our emotions, we can actually feel 30 different ways in 30 days, one day per month. One day you like it, the next day you don't. One day it's good, one day it's bad. One day you like that person, the next day you can't stand them. One day you like this food, the next day you can't stand it. I've actually known some people like that. How can you love a food and the next day not like it? If I like a food, I'm going to like it. I'm going to stay with it. If I like a person, I'm going to like you. I'm going to make the choice to love you, even if I don't like their actions, right? One day they want a car, the next day they don't. But the problem is the day that they want it, they buy it on an emotional high, and oh Lord, the next day they realize, I can't afford this payment. The fact is, there's a couple of facts. One, you will have some days in your future where there will be things that are not favorable to you. Right? Now, faith is something we exercise and we walk in and believe in. And God, the Bible says that faith, you can't please God. It's impossible, it says, to please God without faith. But just because you have faith does not mean that there will be things or days where things are not favorable to you. Right? Amen? Because the Bible says that there will be trouble, but take heart. Amen? But take heart. That's the key. Number two, there will be people who will do things to you that you do not like. They will come against you possibly, say things about you, disappoint you. even if they don't mean to, even if they're good people. But see, here's what we got to have. We've got to have the mindset that I'm not going to be devastated by this or that or whatever. I'm not going to let it control me, because I cannot be on top. I cannot be hearing from God. I cannot have good relationships. I cannot walk in peace, have good health, if I'm all stirred up all the time. I'm going to be consistent in what God says. God says love. God says walk in peace. He's given us love. He's given us joy. He's given us peace as Christians. He's put it on the inside of us. Now we just got to learn to daily walk in it. And we can. That's the good news. These things we can do. We just got to make up our mind and start doing them. And even if we fail, don't quit. Keep doing the right things. In fact, every time you do something well, pat yourself on the back, but at the same time, thank you, God, for giving me the strength and the courage to do that. Thank you, God, for helping me do that better. Amen. Oh, because you have a part to play. You can smile even when you don't feel like it. Bar none. Never seen an athlete do that any better than Magic Johnson. I don't care what they called against him, he would always smile. He could do anything. Instead of going over and yelling at the referee and getting a technical and half his team get a technical and his coach gets thrown out, he'd just go over there and he'd be smiling. And he'd just smile right on through the next call. And if there's another bad call, he'd just keep smiling. But you know what? Must have worked, because he won 5 NBA championships. Must be something to it. I never saw that man. Maybe you can. I'm not saying he didn't, but I don't remember him ever getting a technical foul. I don't remember him ever getting in a major argument with the referee. I'm sure he did, because all players want to win. All champions want to win. But by and large, he just smiled and move on to the next play. That's what we need to do in life. Smile and move on to the next time. Look, there are going to be some people, let's face it, they love to be contentious. They love to pick arguments. They just can't be happy unless they pick an argument or fuss over this or debate that. I'm like, oh my gosh, we got to hear this again. Come on. But I don't tell them that. I just let them say what they want to, smile and move on. Amen. Listen. Do you think, I don't mean this, but most of the time, 99.5%, let me give it that much, I do get up on Sunday morning and I'm excited and I'm full of energy and I'm ready to go. But it ain't 100% of the time. I don't always feel like getting up and just running and jumping and leaping over a wall. But you know what? I got a responsibility to God. I got a responsibility to you. I got a responsibility to myself. And here I am talking about that and showed up late this morning. Shows we're human, right? I'm going to blame it on iPhone. Anyway. Praise the Lord. That wouldn't be truthful. Let's forget that. I just made a mistake. But anyway, most of the time, I do feel like doing what I need to do. But sometimes we don't. Sometimes you wake up with less energy some days. Doesn't mean you're in bad health, not being making a bad confession. It's just we have to talk to our bodies. Say, body, get in line. Amen. Do we always feel like walking in love? How many of you always feel like walking in love? You just love, love just comes over you 100% of the day. I don't think you feel like it, but here's the difference. You may not feel like it, but you can choose to walk in love. Your actions speak louder than your words. See, you cannot just live according to your feelings or you'll get in trouble. I live according to my feelings. I'm going to get in trouble. God has gifted a lot of people in this world that won't go as far as they could have. And you say, well, Mike, why come they didn't go as far as they could have? Because people can't depend on them, and most of all, God can't. One day they're on fire, the next day they've lost all desire to do it. See, here's the thing. I'm certainly not perfect, and I'm certainly not where I need to be, but I do try to be consistent. I'm not the smartest guy around, but I am fairly consistent. I went to school for the same degree, and it's okay if you change degrees now. My oldest son has changed his degree. Many people do that. So I'm not saying you're not consistent, but I'm saying I'm the type of person, if I kind of figure out what I want to do, then let's do it. I went to school for the same thing for 10 years. I've been married to the same person for 23, had the same job for 24. I basically do the same things day in and day out. I don't consider it getting bored. I consider it a responsibility, and I try to make the best of it, even when it's not perfect. You know why? Because I try to be consistent in who God calls me to be and do what I need to do. That's not boredom. That's not routine. That's being consistent, you see. You can be consistent and exciting. You can do it up different ways. Just show up and do it. Amen. See, an unstable person, an inconsistent person, will hug you on Monday and fuss you out on Tuesday. See, God cannot use us, though, if we have that kind of mentality. All of us will now or have worked with people that we don't naturally flow with. But does that mean you can't flow with them? No, you can learn how to flow with them. Amen. And it won't do you any good to run away from them, because there'll be two people just like them at the next place you run to. Right? Philippians 1:28 says, do not be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved even by God himself. Paul here is saying, when you have a problem, just remain consistent. Just remain steadfast. And your enemies even will see that you're going to win, and they're going to lose. When you have a problem, remain consistent. Stay calm. Don't panic, right? You can't win that way in life. Praise the Lord. Psalms 94:12-13 from the Amplified says, blessed or happy, fortunate, to be envied is the man whom you discipline and instruct. O Lord, and teach out of your law, that you give him power to keep himself calm in the days of adversity, until the inevitable pit of corruption is dug for the wicked. In the NLT it says, the same verse says, joyful are those who you discipline, Lord. See, the Bible said that when the Lord disciplines us, it's time to be joyful, because he's doing it for our good. Those you teach with your instructions, it goes on to say, you give them relief from troubled times. It didn't say you make them escape from troubled times, did it? But it says you give them relief from the troubled times. In other words, trouble could be going on in your life all around you, but he's going to give you some relief, because he is teaching you. He is disciplining you. God disciplines us with his love, with his words. He never does it in a mean way. He never does it in a harsh way. He does it with love. And if we'll receive it, oh, envy, the Bible says, is all of us who receive his discipline and instruction. Don't you want to receive his discipline and instruction today? Amen. Hallelujah. Blessed is the man who stays peaceful in the storm. In Acts chapter 27, Paul was shipwrecked. He told everybody, he said, the Lord has already told me it's going to be okay. So just calm down and everything's going to be all right. God has said to us today, we've had some troubles, we've had some shipwrecks in our own life, but stay calm, be consistent, keep doing the things you know to do. I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to instruct you. I'm going to bless you. How many of you believe that? A prosperous soul is one that is stable, not floating around subject to change with every feeling and mood. You see, a swing goes up and down and up and down. A teeter-totter goes up and down and up and down. That can be how some of our moods can be if we don't take them captive. That can be some of our thoughts if we don't take them captive, as the Bible says. Feelings are the believer's number one enemy. We are designed to be emotional creatures by God, and God wants us to feel. He wants us to feel His joy and be touched, whether it's with a shout or with a cry or with an emotional run of joy and leaping for Him. He wants us to feel, but He also wants us to manage our feelings and use them in the right way. Anger is a good example. When Jesus, as I said earlier, went into the money changers and threw the tables over, it was a righteous anger, for He knew that they should not be doing that kind of thing in the tabernacle of God, particularly back in the Old Testament, right? Because the tabernacle was a real building then, not inside our hearts. So He knew that wasn't right, but He did it with the righteous anger. You can be mad at some kind of injustice today, but don't let it creep over into the flesh and you say and do things that are not of the Spirit. Amen. Let your anger always be done as a righteous anger and do it the right way. Anger can be used. Man, I used to tell my players, if you get tired of something, go out there and play with some emotion, but don't let it get to where you're out of control. It's okay to, you want to strive. Gosh, I should have done better on that test. I should have done better in what I did. That's okay as long as you don't get guilt and as long as you let that motivate you to do better, but not to where it controls you and you lose your joy. No. See? Or to where you use anger and it's selfish and you do something or say something that you can't take back. How many of you know yourselves? You can do 99 things just right, and the one time you lose your anger, it's people shouldn't, because God doesn't. But everybody won't remember the 99 things you did good. They'll remember that one time you didn't do so good. That's the way it is, isn't it? So we have to watch ourselves. Luke, and I'll end with this. Turn to Luke chapter 22, verse 39-44. This is a great example here of what I'm talking about today. Luke chapter 22, verse 39-44. I'm reading from the NLT. Excuse me, I say 29, I meant 39. Luke 39 through verse 44. It says, "Then, accompanied by the disciples, Jesus left the upstairs room and went as usual to the Mount of Olives. There He told them, 'Pray that you will not give in to temptation.' And He walked away about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, 'Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done and not mine.' Then an angel from the heaven appeared and strengthened him. He prayed more fervently, and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like drops of great blood." See, Jesus was not in the mood to go to the cross. He did not want to do it in a way. Why? Because He knew it would be painful. It would be agonizing. And He knew that God the Father could not look upon him and would have to turn because he could not look at sin because he took upon the sin of the world. He didn't sin, but he became sin for us. See, Jesus resisted the temptation to not follow his feelings to such a degree that he was sweating drops of blood, the Bible says. But he did it because it was the will of the Father and he loved us. Aren't you so glad that he didn't go by his mood that day? That he did it because it was the right thing to do because his Father wanted him to do it. And most of all, and because he loved us. He didn't have to do it, but he did it out of obedience to his Father and for us so that we might have life eternally in Christ Jesus. So if he can do that, oh, we can resist the temptation to get mad at every little thing, can't we? We can resist the temptation to run from a problem, to quit because it gets a little hard. See, God himself is a gentleman, and he would not force us to do anything, including giving our feelings over to him. We have to make a decision to do it. People sometimes say, I'm out of here. I'm tired of this. I'm leaving. I need to get away. I deserve better than this. Human nature wants to run away from our jobs, our bills, our marriages, problems. But see, God will enable us to be consistent. God Almighty enables us to confront things, to not run from them. He has anointed us to stand still and be steadfast and consistent and to see the salvation of the Lord. You are anointed to be steadfast today. You are anointed to be consistent. You are anointed to be stable. Amen? You are anointed to do it. Why? Because you please him. And the bottom line, as I said at the start, consistency in Christ always. Not sometimes, most of the time, but always wins. Amen? Praise the Lord. Amen. As always, I say, I'm not preaching to you. I'm preaching to myself today. Consistency in Christ wins. Let's just be consistent in him. Don't ever think, well, gosh, it seems like I'm faithful. This is not working. No. The Bible says if you do not quit in due season, you will reap a harvest. I encourage you today. You want good relationships. You want a good job, and you want to move up. Anything you want to enhance your skill, you want to get along with your spouse, anything you do, be consistent in your thoughts and in your actions and in your emotions. We can't always say what we feel because that'll always detract us from where God wants us to be, right? Amen. How many of you believe that today? Amen. Well, I hope today, very simplistic message, but really we need to walk in it. Amen. Consistency wins. It always wins. Not up, not down. Amen. Praise the Lord. I just want to say, those of you that watched it Facebook today, I hope you enjoyed it. And God bless you. I hope I didn't go too long. I went a little longer. I didn't even realize it today than I normally have been lately. But I just felt the Lord, he just gave me some good stuff, I believe. And I talked a little too much, maybe. I need to quit talking down on it. Anyway, praise God. I love you all. Thank you for coming today. Bless you all. And we'll see you Wednesday night here at Fellowship Church. Amen.